11 of your 30-day dental MBA. We're rocking and rolling right along. I'm so happy that you're staying with it. This speaks volumes of your commitment to success by getting all the way to day 11. Keep it up. Make sure the whole team's watching. Get your spouse involved. Get your children involved. Get your family involved. And I don't care if you pass these tapes around. You got some struggling dentist across the street, don't think it's a secret sending these across the street. Do it. Get the word out. I don't think in scarcity. I think abundancy. Let's get bigger. Today we're going to talk about how to develop a winning organization based on human behavior. And as always, we always want to bleed over the last day into the next day to keep it a continuum. Day 10 was how to develop the ultimate dental assistant. And back to the whole team on this winning-based organization culture. Remember, dental assistants, the patient education sheets are everything. You can't find a Fortune 500 product that doesn't come with instructions and warranties. And look how they enforce warranties. If you go buy a brand new tent, take it out to the Grand Canyon camp for a week, then take it back to Walmart and with mud all over and say, when I opened this out of the box, there was a cut on the side. What is their policy? Are they going to argue? They're going to debate? Are they going to take it before a panel? All warranties are enforced, no questions asked. Now, the last data I got on Walmart, they have about a 1% return rate on their merchandise. So I would say the average dentist, if you did $500,000 last year, what's 1% of $500,000? $5,000. Did you warranty, refund, redo $5,000 of the dentistry? Why would it happen to Sam Walton's, Walmart, Sears, JCPenney's, Mervyn's, Target? Why would they run at about a 1% return, and then you run at a 1/100% return? See, that's what we call benchmarking. You know, if you're Chrysler and you come out with a minivan, and the first year you sell, you know, 5 million units of these minivans, okay, does Honda need a marketing survey? Do they need a committee to look into marketing vans? No. Honda, Nissan, Toyota, GM, Ford, they benchmark. They say, look, there's only about 15 players in making cars. If someone comes out and it's a hit, that's our marketing survey. We don't need more data. We don't need a committee. We don't need to sit on this product cycle for 2-3 years as it goes from committee to committee to committee to committee to committee. Move. Action. Think it. You saw it. Act on it. Same thing with warranties and refunds. If everybody in your organizational backyard is doing this behavior, right or wrong, that's the culture. That's the custom. That's the taboo, the belief systems, okay? People, if they something goes wrong, there's a warranty, just enforce it, it's goodwill, it gets ruffled feathers. And also remember, what is the real value of the life of a patient? God, McDonald's places the value of a lifelong customer. You know, 1 in 10 people eat at McDonald's every gosh darn day. McDonald's figures the value of one of their customers on the aggregate is worth $27,000. And you're whining about refunding a $140 filling? Come on, guys, don't look at the trinket. Don't look at the filling, the crown, the root canal, the cleaning. Look at the value of this patient coming in for a lifetime, bringing in their existing social network, immediate family, their spouse, their children, their dad, their neighbor, their coworkers. And when you do these people right and they feel good about it, you know, when you're talking about trying to get someone else to do something for you, you always know one of the easiest ways to get someone to do something for you is you give them a gift. You give them a gift, they always return the favor. I mean, I remember Arm & Hammer. Arm & Hammer is the only person. He made billions of dollars because no one else could deal with Joseph Stalin. And you got to read all the book's autobiographies. And you know, talking about human behavior, look how keen, instinctual insights this little Jewish physician named Arm & Hammer in New York City. He was a physician. Most of the dentists don't realize that. And basically, he was working on his patients, and he kept hearing all these patients saying things like, gosh darn Soviets are so damn stupid. I've been trying to, they have, 200,000 tons of metric wheat rot in the field every year, and I've been down there with their Ministry of Agriculture, and after 3-4 years, finally my boss said, you know, we can't waste any more money trying to do business with these people. They're idiots. Then he had some other patients that were in his office from Standard Oil, old Rockefeller's breakup empire. They were saying, you know, the Soviets got the same amount of oil as Saudi Arabia, and we've been dealing with them for 4 or 5 years about how to get oil out of there. And finally, you know, we've dumped $10 million into trying to do business with these people, going through the Ministry of Oil and the Ministry of Agriculture. These guys are idiots. They don't, you know, blah, blah, blah. They finally gave up. And Arm & Hammer's listening to all this stuff, and he knows human behavior. Remember, billionaires know apes. They know people. They don't know your math, your trigonometry. They didn't go to business school. They didn't get calculus. They don't have a PhD behind their name. If you got a PhD behind your name, you're more likely to be a conformist, where you try to fit the whole round world through your little square peg. Billionaires know people. They don't need to know math. The billionaires, I say, I can find someone to do the math. I can find a lawyer. I can find an accountant. I can find some damn dentist to do a root canal. I want to know people. And Armin Hammer, you know what he did? He flew over to Germany. He studied everything he could on Joseph Stalin. Remember, Joseph Stalin, that's a mean dude, you know, dictator, killed 35 million people. Everybody talks about it. Adolf Hitler killed 11 million. Hell, Joseph Stalin killed 35 million. Mao Zedong's number one, he killed 80 million. Idi Amin's number four at 1.1 million. But he studied everything he could get his hands on about Joseph Stalin. He noticed in all these pictures, he might have had a pack of Marlboro Red about half the time, and sometimes saw Hershey's chocolate bar, so he got a big case. He picked half of it with Marlboro Red, half of it with Hershey's chocolate bars, put it in a case, flew over to Berlin, chartered a jet, and he had to fly it himself because no one would do what he wanted to do. The son of a gun takes off from Germany, crosses over, he's flying right to Moscow, crosses the Berlin Wall. About 2 seconds later, Soviet MiGs are on his tail saying, you've invaded Soviet airspace, we're going to shoot you down, what the hell are you doing? He goes, hey, I got a meeting with Joseph Stalin. Now the MiG fighter's like, oh, Joseph Stalin, oh my God. So they escorted him to Moscow. They parked, the military's there, they picked him up, they said, what are you doing here? Who are you? What are you doing? He says, I'm Armin Hammer. I'm Dr. Armin Hammer from New York City. I have a meeting with Joseph Stalin. They're like, you have a meeting with Joseph Stalin? Oh my God. They got him in the deal. They motorcade him in. They bring him in this office. Joseph Stalin walks out there and says, who the hell are you? He goes, Joseph Stalin, I'm Dr. Armin Hammer from New York. Greetings from New York. And he opens up his case. There it is, half Marlboro Red, half chocolate. Joseph Stalin's got his big smile on his face. He goes, what's the deal? And he goes, well, you know, I just can't understand. He says, I got all these patients, and they're all trying to do business with your wheat, and you got all this wheat rotting in the field, and they've been working 3 or 4 years with your Ministry of Agriculture, and they finally gave up. But more importantly, you got all this oil. You got liquid gold, and 3 years of dealing with the Ministry of Oil, Standard Oil, and all these people gave up. What's the deal? And Joseph Stalin says, I didn't know that. He takes out a sheet of paper. He writes, if you tell Dr. Armin Hammer no, I will kill you. Joseph Stalin. He take that to the Ministry of Agriculture, said, this is what I want to do. There's the birth of Occidental Petroleum. There's the birth of another billionaire. Why? Because he had the keen instinctual insight that he had to find the decision maker. Remember, decisions are made based on how they see the score and its incentives. He had an incentive to get that oil again. It's called money. But Armin Hammer had the keen insight to not deal with the Ministry of Oil for 4 years and lose $10 million like other oil companies. He went to the top. Ray Kroc knew who the decision maker was. It was Mom, and her score was a little kid. So what you need to do is, this behavior is done in your backyard. They need patient education. You know, when Dad comes home from the dentist and Mom says, well, honey, I'm serving dinner in 10 minutes. When are you allowed to eat on that new filling? And he says, he's not going to say, well, honey, I'm a... You know me, I'm dumber than a rock. I don't remember. I forgot to ask. He's not going to say that. He always wrestles everything. He says, well, you know, Dr. Cran, he's only in there 5 minutes, and it costs $100. He's in there 3 minutes. He didn't say nothing. He ran out of the room. He didn't tell me nothing. I don't know. I don't want to go back there. But if you had a patient education sheet, they pull up this sheet. You know, you can drink liquids on it right away. You got to wait 1 hour to eat on it. Yada, yada, yada. Mom's like, it's right here. And then you sit there. You have this. It's operational logistics. If these warranties are all tucked away in files and charts, are in notebooks, you know, you gotta set it up like a McDonald's. These are my deals, they're right by the door. You're walking on the door, how the hell would you miss that? And why do we put a different color? Because apes are visual. They, dental assistants know by the color which one's which for the warranties, on and on and on. To implement consumerism, an instructional sheet with every procedure, preoperative videotapes, instruction sheets, signed legal consent forms, home care instructions with every procedure, always give out the entire walkout statement saying everything that was done, cost incurred of your high quality, great service, family practice. Here's some warranties I've collected. These are for my Bose speakers. They have a warranty. When you feel strongly about something, and I'm taking the opposite of this, it's real easy to beat up amalgam, but I don't like dentists when they talk about mercury toxicity and beating up amalgams, because if you take away amalgams, what do? You didn't do anything to the rich and the middle class. Once again, the poor always get screwed. Safety of dental amalgam, here's an update put out by JADA. I'll be the only practice manager expert. It'll stick my reputation online. Say amalgam safe. And why do I say amalgam safe? You give me all this sheep study. You give me studies about, you keep coming back to this sheep study in Canada. It shows, well, sheep who had fillings and they were getting off 25 picograms of mercury and they yada, 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 yada. Okay, well, let's just say that's all true. First of all, we're not sheep. We don't chew grass all day. You know what sheep do? They chew grass, they swallow, they regurgitate with acid. Okay, maybe that applies to anorexia nervosa and bulimia. But let's say that we're all anorexia and bulimia. We all eat our food 24 hours a day, regurgitating with acid, swallowing again. Let's say 25 picograms is the deal. A good buddy of mine, Ray Bertolotti, who's, you know, Ray Bertolotti, I mean, he's at a whole other level. Ray said, you know, look at the ocean. And the mercury in a silver filling is a salt. It's bond to silver, copper, zinc, or tin. It's an insoluble salt. If I swallow an amalgam, 3 days later, ding, I poop it out, weigh it, weighs the same, wash it off, swallow it again. 3 days later, ding, rinse it off, weigh it, it's the same. You could do that 300-400 times, it's an insoluble salt. But free ethyl mercury and methyl mercury is laden in our little lovely ocean of ours. And what does it do? It's a heavy element. It sinks to the bottom. Well, what happens when it gets to the bottom? Well, there's these fish that feed off the bottom. They're scum-sucking scavengers. You would never eat these kind of animals anyway. They're like lobster and shrimp and clams. And they sit there and they gobble up this free ethyl mercury and methyl mercury that's absorbable. And you sit there, let's say that 25 picograms of mercury given off was the real McCoy. Well, you eat one bowl of popcorn shrimp and you just had a year's supply of that silver filling and in an absorbable form. But more important than that, what if there was a 1 in a 1,000,000 risk something can happen? Well, this is a low-cost, high-quality, consistent restoration for people who don't have the money. Not everybody makes $100,000 a year. Some moms are out there waiting tables at the IHOP or the Waffle House with two kids, a deadbeat husband that skipped state, hadn't paid child support in 7 years. She don't have money for gold fillings, silver fillings, bleachings, veneers. And if gosh darn Mother Teresa or Jesus was a dentist, he'd have his eye on the waitress raising two kids without insurance and just working off tips. Not everybody's going to get a silver filling. So, you know, that's the failure of healthcare. A single high-cost marker stratification that only focuses on the airbags until it breaks on up. There's got to be market differentiation. In fact, I just pulled this out of the newspaper today. I got to read this to you. This is today's newspaper. It says, Appalachia in state of toothlessness. This comes from the Associated Press in Atlanta. Here's another sad distinction for the Appalachian states. More than a third of the elderly people in the region have lost all their teeth, the highest rate in the nation. West Virginia leads the nation in toothlessness. 47.9% of people older than 65 have lost all their teeth. Kentucky, Tennessee, see Al Gore for more, and Georgia aren't far behind, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention reported Thursday. Most of the lower rates were out west. Fewer than 20% of elderly Americans in Arizona, California, Hawaii, and Oregon, and Wisconsin reporting having lost all their teeth. Tooth loss was greatest among blacks, the uninsured, people with less than a high school education, and smokers. So there you go. Everybody beat up amalgams because it's not going to hurt you, Dr. Cosmetic Dentist. It'll just hurt the blacks, the uninsured, people who don't have a high school education, just the poorest of the poor. You know, it's the same thing in Arizona. Everybody beating up these poor Hispanic people that climb over the fence to the land we stole from them to work for $1 an hour picking grapefruit out there and taking care of your kids. And that's the first person you want to shoot and attack when your little Nazi people come out of church. They leave the golf club and they want to drive by these fields and shoot Hispanics. Come on. It's market segmentation. But if you feel like you're in an HMO situation or a PPO or you're Joe Stevens, who just wrote that beautiful article, The Great White Hype. It was a big debate in dental economics where Dickerson was saying that he didn't like silver fillings and Joe Stevens saying he liked silver fillings. And I got to write a referee third-person article saying, hey, it's not neither of you right or wrong. It's market segmentation. There's Taco Bell, Mexican restaurants, but whatever side of the fence you are, get your literature, turn it into a handout. I give these people handouts. And a lot of these handouts I get free from the Department of Oral Health. 43 of the 50 states, if you look in the blue pages, have an office of dental health. Usually it's someone who has a dental degree, DDS or DMD, with a master's in public health. And if you go down there, you'll find out two things. Number one, you'll be probably the only dentist in the state that visited in last year. You'll also find out they have millions and millions and billions and trillions of brochures on chewing tobacco and sealants and gum disease. And the one, Office of Dental Health in Phoenix, I can get brochures on sealants on in Spanish, Farsi, which Iranians speak. I get it in 7 different languages. Just because you know what dental sealants are, do you think everyone knows what sealants are? Do you think that all 265 million Americans know what sealants are? Do you think that all 6 billion Earthlings know what a sealant are? You can get patient education. It's like these free of charge from your office of dental health, or you can call the American the Association of Pediatric Dentistry, call Smart Practice, Jim and Naomi Road, or you can call their son-in-law, who's now running it, physician MD Kurt Hammond, or his daughter, who's a dentist, Beth Road Hammond. There's tons of brochures, but this is internal marketing. In fact, Jim Rohde, for years, got in my office every 6 months, and he was he's like a father figure to me. He'd come out there, and I remember these things he said. He said, Howard, look. He said, you know, I asked him, I think I was 4 months out of school or 5 months out of school. I didn't lecture or nothing. He's just the ultimate hard worker. And he came out and he said, you know, a PPO will come out and say, if you sign up, we'll give you all these patients. All you have to do is drop your fee 30%. And he says, a businessman, instead of dropping his fee 30%, would invest 3% in brochures and marketing and intro cameras and welcome mats and posters on the wall. Do you want to do business with me and invest 3% so you can hang on to that third of your fee? Or do you not want to do business with Smart Practice, just give up a third of your fee and go to a PPO? And I shook his hand. I said, thanks for that tip, Jim. And, you know, if you ever come up to Phoenix, you got to stop by Smart Practice, just do a tour of it. If you're a specialist, dental assistant, this is key with specialists. This is my number one criteria for a specialist. If your specialist, endodontist, periodontist, pediatrics, prosthodontist, oral surgeon, endodontist, if they refer to themselves as a specialist and is too proud to admit that they are a dentist, then they will not co-diagnose these patients and create a two-way referral street. I cannot stand oral surgeons. I mean, oral surgeons are the elitist bunch of pigs out there. I mean, here you get a new patient, you do an FMX, you do a complete exam, you learn it from Dawson, the Pink Institute, you learn it from all of you, do a complete exam, and part of your exam, you diagnose everything, even the things that have no income benefit to you, like the removal of these wisdom teeth that they can't clean, they got gingivitis around or impacted or whatever, and you took your time, you made the referral, you sent over there, and what does your oral surgeon do? He just pulls them and sends you back. No way, I want a two-way street. I don't want cookies at the end of the year. I don't want to send you 30 sets of wisdom teeth and get a deal of chocolate chip cookies or donuts at Christmas or an Easter basket deal. I want, when the dental assistant gets a referral card to the specialist, I want her to fill it out, Xerox it, then Xerox my treatment plan, give the referral card to the patient, but then fax the referral to the oral surgeon, fax the treatment plan with it, and I want my oral surgeon to walk in and not say, hi, I'm Dr. Narrow-Minded, all I do is pull wisdom teeth, in fact, I don't even know if you have any arms and legs. I want him to get in the mouth, look at my treatment plan, and say, do you agree with it? Do you disagree with it? Did I miss something? And I want the oral surgeon to get in there and say, yeah, Dr. Fran's right. You do need to get these wisdom teeth out. You can't clean around them. You can't floss around them. You got gingivitis. You got some bone loss. They're impacted. Whatever. But I'll tell you what. Did he tell you about this crown over here? That's right. Yeah, you need to get that crown done there because that's a big cavity underneath that. You see that on your x-ray? And if you don't get that crown done in a timely manner, you know, it's going to get into the nerve. And then you're going to be looking at twice the cost with a root canal and a crown. And remember, 4 or 5% of those, at least 1 in 20 of those root canals fail. So remember, I know after you get these wisdom teeth out, you probably won't want to see a dentist again for a week or two or whatever, but don't let this tooth that needs crowned wait. And I have patients all day long come back and say, oh, Dr. Fran, you were right. My God, I went and I had my wisdom teeth pulled, and he said I better get right back in there, because usually what happens, after they get their wisdom teeth pulled out, which I like to get the gum sealed up first, the wisdom teeth out first, because I don't want to put a crown on a second molar with mushy tissue, and then after you get that crown on there and you get the tissue cleaned up, it shrinks back, and the oral surgeon's pulling a wisdom tooth, and he dangers my crown or cracks the porcelain or pops it off. I like to do first things first. I like to get the exam, I get the wisdom teeth out, I like to get the gums all healed up, then do my restorative, unless they're in pain. Pain's always first, obvious. But man, make your specialist a two-way street. It all comes down to the assistant. And I want my assistants to know their assistants. If you got an oral surgeon and you've got a dental assistant been with you for 6 years, and I walk in your office and say, who have you been referring all your wisdom to? Dr. Elitist Pig. And how long have you been referring to him? 6 years. How long have you worked here? 6 years. What's his receptionist name and what's his assistant name? Oh, I don't know. Specialists, you know they're the most elitist, because if you ever go to a dental convention, one-third of all the dentists have all their staff there. Once again, another market stratification. The dentists who bring all their staff to continuing ed on the aggregate almost double the income of all the stupid people who come by themselves because they think, well, it'll save me money. I'll just get the information and give it to my staff. You really think You're going to take an eight-hour seminar and present it to your staff. Hell, you never talked at Toastmasters once. You have no slides, no material. And what are you going to condense, an eight-hour seminar into 5 minutes? See, you got to invest money into your players. If I have a basketball team, I don't want the owner to go to a basketball team yet. I want the players to go practice together all day, every day. So you go to a specialist convention. I have talked to a room. In fact, just Tuesday, MTS Manji had a lecture here just for specialists, Expertent. And by the way, if you want a great consultant to come in your office, Expertent's one of the best. You can call Expertent at 1-888-977-8722. His phone number is 1-888-977-8722. And I'll just say one thing about MTS Manji in office consulting. My hero is Gordon Christian. When Gordon Christian needed a consultant to come in his office to do just get things tidied up or whatever, any practice management consultant in the world would have done it free of charge, or hell, even paid him $10,000 just to say, I did Gordon's office. Who did Gordon call? When in the United States, he calls Canada, he calls MTS Manji, he's a legend up there, and he paid MTS Manji full fee, retail. Could you imagine having the goal to charge Gordon Christian retail? MTS knows what he's worth. If you want to in-office consultant, call that guy. He's got 10 regional centers. But what you have to do. But anyway, he was lecturing here, I believe it was Wednesday. And it was mostly oral surgery. It was all specialists, only four specialists. No staff. There wasn't a single staff member in the room. That is so much like a specialist. They think the whole world is them. And they just, you know, do their root canal and send you a bag. They don't care about nothing but their little root canal, their little wisdom tooth. And you got to break the chain. You got to build dental system, a relationship. Your receptionist doctor needs to know the reception over there. That way, when your patient calls up, if you don't like molar endo, you can't afford to do molar endo, okay? Refer it. But when they call it a toothache, you refer them to an endodontist. And the endodontist says they can't get them in for a week. They're sitting there in pain. Finally, their girlfriend says, you know, my dentist does root canals. You ought to call him. He might get you in today. We get so many emergency patients in that way. But if your recept has a long-term relationship, she calls her up, Judy, this is Karen from Dr. Fran's office, and one of my best patients here, and she's got a toothache, and doctor doesn't want to do the root canal, and she's in a lot of pain, and I don't want her to wait, and she's got a relationship. They're like, oh, don't worry. I'll squeeze her in at 1 o'clock. My endodontist is fat. He don't need to go to lunch. I'll work her right in. He'll do the whole thing. Don't worry about a thing. It's all about relationships. Billionaires are about people and relationships, not about filling out some little index card and a referral card and giving it to him and sending him back out into the jungle. Everybody wants to be relationship guided, not thrown back into the wild chaos of the jungle. So basically, then your assistant, every time you make a referral to an endodontist, periodontist, pedodontist, orthodontist, whatever, you fill out the card you give to the patient. If they need to be seen right away or if they got anything quirky, it's just value-added customer service. Remember, it's only best service, best product, or best price. Best price is least defensible. Best product your patient won't understand. The only thing you'll understand if it's white, tooth color, looks good, didn't hurt. But best service is like when they're checking out, we set them down from an operator's logistics point of view. Just say to them, by the way, do you want me to get them on the phone for you? I know Marianne, the receptionist, is a real sweetheart. I've known her for years and years. Do you want me to get her on the phone for you? Oh, that'd be great, because I'm wondering, because I think I met my deductible here, but will there be an insurance there? Oh, hell, let's just get her on the phone. Hey, I'll pick up that line there. I'll pick up this line. Let's all three talk. And that's just customer service. They feel like they're in the good hands, people. Today's dental's taking care of you every step of the way. Specialists are a cash flow drain if all they do their one little procedure. But if they're co-diagnosing, just like your hygienist, empowered with a uniform and a name tag and an intraoral camera, talking English, going to all your continuing ed, if your specialist is doing co-diagnosis for what you do, my gosh, it's absolutely all the same family. Make it a two-way referral road. Don't sit there and make it a one-way street. And take this tape to your specialist and cram this tape down his mouth and say, you do this. And smart practice also, Jim Rohde taught me this deal about his blood pressure monitor. For $181, you can call Smart Practice at 1-800-522-0800, 1-800-522-0800. And, you know, when you're, I'm 36 years old. I don't care about my blood pressure. I've never had a physical. I'm still at the end of that period where you think you're young and live forever. But they say when you're over 50 or 55, you start really wondering about your blood pressure. He's got a little blood pressure kit. The hygienist, the assistants. By the way, you know, before you give anybody anesthetic with any epinephrine, legally, ethically, according to all the dental schools, You're supposed to take a blood pressure. You can't give some guy epinephrine. What if he had a blood pressure going 180 over 120 and you gave him a bunch of epi? So taking a blood pressure, not only is it supposed to be protocol, which I say supposed to because I know I might be a little anal, but I know 90% of the dentists don't do this. But look, it's a value-added service. Taking a patient's blood pressure at every appointment is a great value-added service. Bundle it into your current fee. It is medically necessary before you use any vasoconstrictor epinephrine-containing anesthetic, and patients over 40 love it. And it's a neat little kit, and look at Walgreens. Remember, Mr. Walgreens, this guy knew it all. 24-hour pharmacies, drive-through, group practice. And what does he have at every Walgreens? You go in there, it doesn't even cost you a dime. You sit in that chair, you put your arm in the deal, you push a button, and in fact, next time I see Jim Rohde, I'm going to ask him about that machine and if he can introduce that to dentistry. I'm going to ask Pete Frechette about that or Stan Bergman at Henry Schein. But I really think that if someone really checked out that machine, that'd be a really neat thing to sit out in the waiting room. Now, dental assistants, staff, receptionists, the two most common reasons that 56,399 people gave the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention Atlanta reasons for not having a dental visit in the past year. Everyone thinks always money, 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 money. Now look, this is the biggest study ever done on it, and the number one reason was they perceived they did not have a problem. Reason number two was cost. Cost was 26.6%. Perceived they didn't have a problem was 44.6%. The average dentist retires with about $1.8 million of dentistry that was diagnosed over the years that was never done not only by him, it was never done by anyone. You left $1.8 million on the table. You thought it was all cost. You thought it was all insurance. And 44.6% of it was because you sit there and you go in the hygiene deal and, you know, you don't allow your hygienist to talk because you're low self-esteem, you're anally retentive, and you think you got to be a nuclear brain surgeon. Come on, doctor. There's a hole in the tooth. It's a cavity. What do you need, a CAT scan, an MRI, a Ouija board? You think this hygienist doesn't know that? And you don't let her talk, and then you go in there and you say, Margaret, chart that he needs an MO on tooth number 3 and a DO on tooth number 4. Okay, Fred, other than an MO and a DO, you're doing fine, and I'll see you later. He don't know what an MO or a DO is. He goes home, his wife says, well, how was your appointment? He said, well, the only thing he remembers, he said, well, you're doing fine. He said, I'm doing fine. I mean, the CDC want to know, how come Grandpa just came home from the physician, he has a prescription for high blood pressure pills, only 11% of them get filled, and they're sitting there looking at Grandpa like, well? And Grandpa's like, well, what? Well, the visit with the physician. Well, what happened? It went great. Like, what do you mean it went great? He just said, you have high blood pressure. You're going to have a stroke. You're going to die. Cerebral vascular accident is the third highest cause of death in America. Why the hell aren't you getting it filled? And Grandpa says, you mean I have high blood pressure? They're like, oh, my God. And they're going back there. They're filming. They're surveying. They're watching these physicians. They're talking Latin and Greek. It's one-way communication. The pupils are going off. Grandpa's not hearing. He's totally lost. He comes back and focuses on right when he hears the physician say, have a nice day. He walks out there. Why don't you, if the physician would blow off the whole hour consultation, just walk in and say, Grandpa, you're going to die. You got high blood pressure. See these pills? If you took a blue pill every day, you might not die from it. When the blue pills run out, come back and see me. Now repeat that to me. Are these suppositories? No, let's start over, okay? Okay, not in your rear end, in your mouth, okay? One blue pill in your mouth every morning, you got high blood pressure, okay? I mean, talk English, and I think that's why you got to empower dental assistants, hygienists, and receptionists, because I really think that dentists get so lost after 8 years of college, so much physics and calculus and microbiology and Krebs cycles and periodic tables, I think they almost can't even talk to a third of the people. They're so anal. So empower your assistants. Make them long-term. And dentists always come back and always say to me the weirdest thing. Say, yeah, well, you can get sued for having an assistant do that because that's an exam. You know what? Well, go ask Jeffrey Toner how many dental assistants or doctors were sued from having the dental assistant talk in the last 10 years, and he'd probably tell you to go check yourself in Charter Hospital. And when you talk to these people, remember, they got to be looking at their tooth on the ceiling while you're talking. This guy's laying there while I have frozen his picture on the top. This guy comes in, and I said, how am I helping you? Now, he's sitting up in his chair first, and Jan's down there like Vanna White, you know, with the bowel pointing as I'm talking. And when you walk in there, you don't dogmatically one-way shove something down this guy's throat. You sit there and say, how am I help you? Just like the vet. And this guy was very mad. He was very mad. And the madder they get, dental assistants, reception, staff, do not walk into the doctor's room and say, hey, the guy in room 3 is really pissed off. He's really mad. He hates you. Let's go. Now your doctor, he's got blood clots, he's letting gas, he goes in the bathroom, he hurls up his coffee, he doesn't want to go in there. And, you know, before the Bulls game, they turn down the lights, they razz up the music, and the teammates try to fire each other up. Why don't you walk in there and say, hey, doctor, are you ready to go? Did you get a lot of sleep? Did you pound that coffee down? We got a good game going in room 4. Come on, let's go win this guy over. He doesn't have to know he's walking into a damn tornado or a hurricane or a 50-mile-an-hour headwind. And you walk in there and you go, hey, Frank, how you doing? You go, Frank, what's going on, buddy? He said, oh, my filling broke. That's what you did. I said, well, good. I don't like him to last more than 6 months. Let's take a look at it. And I stick cameras around and say, well, which one is it? He goes, that one right there. I said, well, Frank, what happened? He goes, well, my filling broke. It's what you did. I said, Frank, your filling looks great. Where the hell's your tooth? He goes, I think it was my filling. Frank, see the big black thing right there? See that black thing? That's the filling. Where's your tooth? And he goes, oh, so that was my tooth? Yeah, where is it? Well, I don't know. I said, how'd it break? I don't know. Well, were you in a car wreck? Did your wife hit you? Did you get in a bar fight? And he goes, no, I didn't get in a bar fight. My wife didn't hit me. I don't know. I just woke up this morning and noticed it broke. I said, well, when do you think it broke? I think it broke maybe last night at dinner. I said, what were you eating? He goes, meatloaf. Who made it? My wife. Frank, I'd get a new wife, man. If she's making me meatloaf, my teeth break all like that, I'd get a new wife. And he says, oh, no. So you're saying it's my tooth? I said, Frank, who did this filling? He's going, well, I thought it was the one you did. No, Frank, see that filling? That filling's black. Okay, we do white ones. We don't do black ones. Okay, these are 50% mercury, 30% silver, a little bit of 12% copper, zinc, or tin. They're fine. They're the old days. But, you know, when the gas station attendant took the lead out of gas, I thought we'd take the mercury silver out of fillings. We do tooth color. They're prettier. Because, see, the tooth-colored fillings, it's not so much that they're white. I mean, come on, Frank, I'm bald. You look like you fell out of a truck. I said, what we like the white ones for is because they adhesively glue the tooth back together. The initial design of a white filling was that it was an adhesive dentistry. It glued the whole tooth together. You know, Sir Isaac Newton said there were 6 forces. He said if there was a lever. He said the lever is long enough you could lift up the world. He said if a lever went around, it was a screw. He said if a lever went over a wheel, it was a pulley. If it went into a wheel, it was a wheel and axle. And he said if it, 2 levers came together, it was a wedge. And remember the farmers like Daniel Boone, they put that wedge in a gosh darn tree trunk, they'd smack in a wedge into 2. See, these are non-adhesive dentistry. And these things, you know, they're like a wedge. Now, Frank, you've been coming here 5 years. Now, you better get this right. What kind of filling is this? I know, it's a flossing filling. Right, because see, look where the filling is. See, everywhere you brush, you've never had a cavity. You're 55 years old, Frank. You've never had a cavity where you brush. But everywhere you floss, not only, now what kind of flossing filling is this? I don't know, I just thought it was a floss. No, Frank, it's not a flossing filling. It's a double flossing filling. And Frank, not only is it a double flossing filling, what is this big brown gunk underneath here? What is that right there? That's a flossing cavity. Not just one, you have one on both sides. Frank, you have a double flossing cavity underneath a 30-year-old double flossing filling. Frank, you got to give me a high five, buddy. I mean, I bet you worked hard to grow a big old burger like that. I mean, I bet you haven't flossed one time in 30 years, Frank. I mean, not every day do you see a double flossing cavity under a double flossing filling. Now, Frank, what do we have to do with this today? You know, well, can you fill it? Fill what? Frank, what do you think of this? Michael Jordan palming a gosh darn ball? You can't hang on to that. You only got one tooth over here. And he says, so, what do we have to do? I said, Frank, look at this tooth behind her. What do we do here? I said, Frank, what's that? Jan, hand me the periodontal probe. She hands me the periodontal probe. I sit there and go, ah! See, Frank, that's the nerve. Now, Frank, what do we do back here? Jan, when did we do this one behind it? 4 years ago. Frank, remember you came here 4 years ago? Same damn thing. Root canal, built and crown. Came in here, what was that, Jan? 8 years ago? Same damn thing. Root canal, built and crown. And, Frank, I told you, you know, when you first came in, I think it was in 1987, I told you that this needed to take out, and you need to put a new gold inlay, onlay, you need to fix this thing up, you need to start flossing, you come in every 6 months for a cleaning, but Frank, I love you, because you won't come in for a cleaning, you won't floss, you just like come in every 2 years, give me $2,000, in fact, Frank, will you please do me a big favor, we're trying to budget for next year, and I noticed that you have this double flossing filling, it's cracked down the middle, I told you to replace that 3 years ago, and if you crowned it today, See, it'd just be a crown for like 700. But see, if you promise not to floss it and promise to wait till the whole thing busts out, it'll be $1,600. So, Frank, please don't crown this one right now for 600 when you can just wait one more year and I'll get 1,600. And they start laughing. So you're saying I need a root canal and a crown here and a crown here. I said, hell yeah, Frank, I'm saying. I've been saying it since 1987. And I don't care if you do, don't. I don't care either way, whatever you want to do. And once again, they'll say, oh, I suppose I'm going to make a mortgage payment on your house. Frank, there's no mortgage on a house. It's free and clear. Jen, go get them a Xerox copy of it. Do you want to see the title, Frank? Frank, why don't you come over to my damn house? Hell, you pay for my damn house. Oh, hell, I'll come over to the house. I'll buy you a drink. And he's like, and they just laugh. But talk English. Don't sit there Latin and Greek, anal or retentive, dry, while their pupils are drifting off or they're not comprehending them. Bring it down to the level. I talk to all these people. When they come in there, I always do a mental trick on me. I always try to match this guy up with, who is this guy most matched to my family reunion or my wife's family reunion? I mean, if you ever go to a foreign family reunion in Parsons, Kansas, the only thing worse than that is my wife's family reunion in Caldwell, Kansas. See, Parsons, 35,000, and Caldwell is only 2,000. And, I mean, my God, you put our two family reunions together, it looks like a genetic freak show, okay? I got uncles coming in that hadn't worn underwear in 10 years, overalls, whole nine yards, and I talked to him just like it'd be one of my uncles. And I wouldn't sit down with my uncle with a bunch of panos and sefs and study models and talk a bunch of Latin and Greek. I'd just look him in the eye and tell him like it is and tell him the damn truth, and he'd take it like a man and be glad for it. And this guy comes in, what do we tell him? Okay, what you got here is you got two, when did you have those done, Amy? Oh, I don't remember. Well, I mean, was it yesterday? Was it a week ago? Was it last year? When do you think you had it done? You know, I think I must have been about 18 years old. I said, okay, well, look, you're 38. You had these done 18. They're flossing cap filling. See, everywhere you brush, there's air. There's 20.9% oxygen. Anaerobes don't live. Everywhere you have gingivitis and fillings in between your teeth. These are, you got them done about, you think, about 14 to 18. Now you're 38. So they've been in there, what, 20 years? And what do you have under there 20 years later? Two more flossing cavities again. So then you take them out and you put them back in there. I said, now look, Amy, the only reason we put these white ones in there is so that it glues them back together. Now, you say it's cosmetic dentistry. The insurance tries to get out of paying it by saying it's cosmetic dentistry. Look, I didn't do it because it's cosmetic dentistry. I did it because it is adhesive dentistry. It glues the walls back together. Those silver ones, they sit in there like a wedge. Every time you bite down on them, they push the teeth apart. And when you put these wedges in the teeth, if you leave them in there long enough, they will do their job and they will wedge the tooth in two. See, all wedges, if left in long enough, will do their job and wedge a tooth in two to get your tooth either a crown, or if you leave it in long enough, you'll get a root canal and a crown. See, dentists don't leave these in their teeth. Most every dentist I knew had all these things ripped out before they even got out of dental school. Hell, you're sitting there in a sophomore class in dental school saying, damn, I got one in my mouth. Once you know what these things are, they're wedges. Ask Daniel Boone what will happen if you leave a wedge in a log and keep jumping on it and hitting it long enough. Eventually, it'll split firewood for you. So we're not going to split firewood, and we're going to do adhesive dentistry. But I'll tell you what, Amy, you had two floss cavities at 18. They put in two flossing fillings. It's 20 years later. You got two flossing cavities again, and we put in two more flossing fillings. But see, now you're 38. When you don't floss from birth to 40, you basically just get flossing cavities. But you don't floss from 40 to 70. It's not a question if you get, I don't even care about the cavities. It's the gums. You know, 27 out of 100 Americans don't have any teeth at 65. And it's all from gum disease, all in between the teeth. And I love the Far Side joke the best. He says, your teeth are great, but your gums got to go. And you want to wear a denture about as much as you want to wear a glass eye or a wooden leg. You know, if you got a wooden leg, you can walk from point A to point B, but you don't run, skip, or hop. Plastic teeth, you can eat, but you're not biting into a bacon cheeseburger and tearing chicken in half and chewing the cartilage off an antelope's knee while it's still kicking. You cut up your foods in small pieces and then empower your staff. From a human behavior point of view, you know, this is my dental assistant's room or my hygienist room. Take all their continua, their plaques, put their family up there, put all this stuff up there, put them in a uniform, put them in a name tag, take them to all your continuing education, because every time your dental assistant hygienist receptionist moves up a notch, they lift you up even higher. Remember what Igor said, 2 + 2 = 5, okay? And you got to get these photo albums. I think I sell the best ones, but I'm not trying to sell you a photo album, but you can buy one. Call my the Ferrani Port at 1-602 598-0001. You know, I get more dentists that call up that number and say, what's your 1-800 number? Can I call you back on your 1-800 number? Here's what I say about my 1-800 number. Screw you! If you can't afford a long-distance phone call, you're not a client of mine. My gosh, you're so tight. But on these photo albums, the only reason I did my own photo album, because everyone else, I mean, Jack Welch of GE. GE has 25 companies. Jack Welch says he can buy and sell these companies and manage them all day long because he has their business convention index card. He said, if the CEO of this company can't tell me on an index card 5x7 if he's best product, best service, best price, what's his unique selling proposition, he's got to be first, second, or third in the industry, kicking ass, profitable, or we're selling it. And the minute he's not best product, best service, best price in a 1, 2, or 3-person race, he's got to be first, second, or third in his industry, and he's got to be number one in best product, best service, or best price, preferably at least 2 out of 3. It has to be 2 out of 3. He sells the company. And as long as he's got that on index card, he'll kick butt. And then you open up these photo albums, and look, I mean, if you can't explain what was done here to a sixth grader, and when people say explain a sixth grader, a lot of dentists think, well, that's insulting. My clientele is smarter than a sixth grade average. We're not talking about a sixth grade mentality as far as they're being stupid. We're saying, look, I'm 36. I have a doctorate in dental surgery. I have a master's in business administration. But if you're selling me a transmission job, I want you to bring it down to a fourth grade level. It's not that I'm stupid. It's that I have no understanding of transmissions, timing chains, ball bearings, motor weight oil. My wife does. She grew up on a farm with 5 brothers. She pulled 3 transmissions before she was 16. We're always driving down the road, and she'll like mute Alanis Morissette and say, you hear that? Your lifters. And I say, well, if you turn the damn stereo back up, it goes away. But if you're going to talk to me transmission, condense it to a 5x7 card. Make your own photo albums. In fact, I make my photo albums look like you made them. I get these things at a Walmart. And what I'd really like you to do is get this photo album and get to a camera and have the goal that the next 5 years, you'll replace all my pictures with yours. A lot of dentists sit there and they call me up and say, yeah, but I think that's unethical to be showing this work as if it was my own when it's not. I'm like, you're so anal. When you walk into a cosmetologist, do you sit there and say to the girl, hey, did you do all those bouffants? Are you trying to tell me you did all those people? Huh, did you? Everybody knows that they're not. It's not making a claim to fame. It didn't say work by you. It didn't say work by me. In fact, when you look at those big dental pictures, and those egomaniacs, Elmer, are so egomaniac, they're selling you a picture of this big dental smile, and they're so egomaniac they have to put their name on it. You won't find my name on anything I make. Poster boards for the same thing. I want it to look homegrown, like you made it in the bathtub. You made dental pictures on Monday, a photo album on Tuesday, and gin on Wednesday. I want you to sit there, make it look homegrown, communicate with your employees, your patients. Behavioral psychology has a simple premise. A series of predictable rewards and punishments can be used as incentives to induce a subject to alter its behavior. So you basically know your market, know how people work. Women are the decision makers in dentistry. Now in 1960, 38% of women were in the labor force. 1993, it's gone to 57%. And percent of married women with children under 18 in labor force in 1960, it was only 28%. 1993, it's 68%. This is why, staff, your hours, doctors will come at me and they'll giggle and say, well, you're right. You know, we still work banker's hours. Yeah, maybe banker's hours in 1960. Have you gone to the bank in the last 10 years? 24 hours a day, they plug them in grocery stores, they got ATM machines. If you think you're working banker's hours, you got another thing coming, buddy. You're still stuck in 1960. Back in that great sovereign profession days, it's consumerism now. 7% of employees care for an elderly loved one. 6% of employees have more than one job. Full-time workers spend 138 hours more per year working in 89 than they did 69. You know, the whole big premise is that as soon as they got a dishwasher and a microwave and a disposal and electric trash compactor, you'd have so much more time to sit on the couch. Every time they come out with more stuff, you end up working harder. Remember when the computers came out and they said it'll reduce paper? God, my God, I've never used so much paper in my life than I went to a computer. I think I have a full-time forest growing in the backyard. What are the top 10 most important criteria that employees are looking for? Competitive salaries, number one. Number two, an enjoyable work environment. You got to make them have pride of workmanship. empower them, take them to CE, give them their entrepreneurship operatory, their treatment room, give them their own treatment room, let them put their stuff there, just like a cosmetologist does hair. You'll walk in there and she'll say, oh no, come over here, that's not my station. You go to her station, got her little kids, pictures, all of her little stuff. Number three, fun is a core value. About one out of every 100 people that goes to my seminar, gets any of my books or tapes, they always have to write me an annual return letter telling me I was unprofessional, they were watching it in their waiting room and they found this to be low taste or whatever. I always take a big red magic marker and I write on it real big, get help, and mail it back to them. Number four, where work is not a four-letter word, have fun at work. I mean, look at Southwest Airlines. Southwest Airlines and America West both have 5% of the market. Southwest Airlines owns all their aircraft, which means they're profitable, and they have made a profit every quarter for 40 quarters in a row. America West leases all their aircraft. They've had layoffs, their stock's gone to zero, and what does the newspaper say tonight? What's going on tonight? Do you hear that in the news? They're going on receptionists or flight attendants are going on strike. How come both people have 5% of the market? One's having their dental flight attendants going on strike, and they've gone in Chapter 11 three times, and they lease all their aircraft, and the other one owns all their aircraft, and he's never had a strike, and Herb Keller's the only airline company in the world whose pilots are not part of the National Pilot Union. His own pilots have their own group of Southwest pilots, and they don't need to go through some union. And look at when you get on a plane at Delta or American, you got these flight attendant girls in these black stiff shoes, high heels with these little tight skirts and girdles. They've never smiled once in 5 years. No one's having fun. Everything's anal. And everybody that owns the company thinks it's professional. The only people they impress are doctors, dentists, and lawyers, and other anally retentive people. You go on Southwest Airlines, tennis shoes, khaki shorts, having a fun t-shirt. And then they sit there and they're taking off. They're saying, they say things like, you know, if you hate yourself, please do not fasten your seatbelt. That way, if we ever have an accident, you'll be quicker to die. I mean, they're always saying funny things, funny jingles. They'll get on there and sing like the theme song to Gilligan's Island, but they'll change all the words. They're just funnier in hell. And they come by, they'll come by your place, and they'll say, tonight, would you like steak or chicken? You'll say, chicken, and they'll throw you a bag of peanuts. And the next guy says steak, they throw him the same bag of peanuts. All they do is have fun. Make fun a core value. Fun is something where, I've been in a dental office before with a receptionist. We were doing a soul stab meeting, and the receptionist, she giggled one time. I think she actually said to the doctor's wife, is it okay to laugh? I thought, is it okay to laugh? What kind of a pervert environment is this? Where work is not a four-letter word. Make it fun. A fun and enjoyable customer base. Remember the Nicole Brown Simpson. My gosh, you don't make love, kiss, and hang out with people who beat the hell out of you and eventually hack you to death, okay? And you sit there, if you've got customers who aren't having fun, who are very anal, who are very mad, let alone ever use profanity or chew you out or rip you a new one, when those people leave, you call them back up and say, Frank, I was very disturbed with the way you acted. Obviously, the way you act like that is because you lost all faith in your doctor-patient relationship, your doctor-assistant relationship, your doctor-hygiene relationship, and you certainly lost in me the doctor-receptionist relationship, and there are 2,000 dentists in Maricopa County. You certainly don't need to come here. You give me the name of a dentist, I'm shipping your chart, your x-rays out, and yada, 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 and the assistant receptionist is too intimidated to do that. You're the bull elephant there. You get on the phone, numbnuts, and you call that guy. I don't ever want to see you in here because my dad told me 1,000 times, the customer never comes first. Your staff comes first so that they can treat the customer right. And when the customer gets you to pray in the relationship between your long-term staff and your customer, you always side with your staff. The customer does not come first. He comes second. Your staff comes first. Those are your team members. You defend them, and yada, yada, yada. And when any customer wants to go over their head, I walk up there, and they say, why do you want to see me? Well, she's saying yada, 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 and I know that, we've known each other for 10 years, and I just want to tell you, I want to see what you think. I said, well, I just try to do everything she says because I'm just afraid one day she's going to fire my ass and hire some 20-year-old dentist out of school with tall, dark, and handsome and send me off to the gosh darn funny farm. That's the receptionist. She owns this place. She gives my paycheck. I do whatever she does. I'd find another damn dentist. And they're just gold. But my receptionist, she's standing up proud. She's beating her chest. And she's looking at that numbnut like, see, I know what I'm doing. Don't go around me. Military. You got 2 million employees in the military. You got Trident submarines that could go out to sea, turn around, and take out every single city, over 50,000 people in its own America in 10 minutes. How does the military guard against that ever happening? Number one, what is the cardinal sin of the military? What is the ultimate career buster in the military? You do it one time, you're out of the military, you'll never be promoted. You know what it is? Not AWOL, it's worse than that. What's the number one cardinal sign? Can I get this copy nuked? Pretty please. Break the chain of command. I mean, when you first go into the military, the first thing you do is they say, paint all the, if it, the first thing they tell you when you walk in the army, they say, they give you a can of green paint and a paintbrush. They say, okay, if it doesn't move, paint it green. Everybody just starts painting everything green. One guy raised his hand and says, well, this one doesn't need painted. You don't get it. No one in the military takes care of more of 8 people, and then those 8 people, they each take care of 8 people, and it starts off with one CEO, commander-in-chief, and works its way down, all the way down the bottom of the chain, and you don't break the chain of command. And so what you do is a fun, enjoyable customer base. Number 6, how much your organization cares for them. Number 7, intelligent and nice people to work with. Number 8, variety in the work. Number 9, ease of moving back and forth from management to individual contribution. Sometimes you'll have a staff member, a receptionist, go from maybe a receptionist to the office manager. 2 years later, she's got a baby or whatever. She's like, I wish I never would have taken this promotion. Make it an easy two-way street to say, really, you want to go back from an office manager back to receptionist? That's fine. Latest, most up-to-date dental equipment technology. No one wants to work in a place with dingy equipment. You want to work in an airline company that's got new planes, new trains, new equipment. Make it fun to work with. And on your organization, just make it fun. Organizations must learn how to manage and sustain change as part of a continuous process of improvement, renewal, and transformation. You know, disintegrate really breaks down into dis and integrate. Integrity is wholeness. Disintegrate is to undo. It means mind, body, family, spirit, and community. The 3 rules of managing a family business, since we usually have a spouse there, once again, family members do not work in the business unless they're at least as able as any non-family member and work at least as hard. The doctor's spouse is either the number one asset in the business or she's the number one disaster. And what's the difference? Some of the women are in there, the spouses are the women doctors, husbands, and they say, well, my gosh, I don't have to say all the incentives at stake. I mean, they should have a bigger incentive to make this work than anybody else. That's why when you go to continuing ed, the doctor's there, usually his wife's there, but they don't bring in staff because, you know, they don't understand team building. But they'll sit there, and she's either, the doctor's wife is either the first one to work, the last one to leave, and thinks about dentistry in the middle of the night and is doing books, billings, insurance, dealing with accountants, or she's ours, or no one can depend on her. And you're sitting there on Monday morning, and the phones are ringing, and the reception's up there thinking, well, where's this damn wife? She's supposed to be here at 8 o'clock. And the doctor's up there giggling, well, she woke up this morning, and her mom has diarrhea, so she's going to go over there and change her depend underwear. And the receptionist's smiling back to you like, because you're her boss. But she's taking aside that little wench. I wish hell she'd quit and I could rely on someone. How would you like to be out there in the bulls and you go throw the ball to Michael Jordan and he's not there? Okay? One top job in the family business, one top job is always filled by an outsider who is not a member of the family. The mafia called this person their conciliar. This person not even Sicilian. Usually it was a Jewish lawyer or a Jewish CPA or a Jewish accountant. All non-family member professionals have to be treated with equals, with full citizenship in the firm. If the doctor's wife is in there, and the doctor's in there, the staff are kind of caught in between. Because number one, you got, you know, what if the doctor tells you to go right and the wife says go left? There has to be an outsider, a conciliar. Maybe it's the longest staff person there, the oldest, the most self-esteem. Maybe it's a high just been there 10 years, or maybe it's a receptionist or someone that the staff can say, well, here's the outsider, because here's the dilemma. Doctor said go right, the wife said go left, and in the military they have an exact chain of command, and I'm sitting here in a family business, I don't have an exact chain of command. I got 2 people telling me 2 different things. Remember how stupid dental school was? If you didn't have the same instructor start yes, finish you, you never pass. Because if you started with one instructor, you'd say, okay, I want you to do this, this, this. So you get in there and do this, this, this. And then he went to lunch. So you get any other instructor, it'll never be right. Because dentistry's art. No two dentists ever saw the same filling, crown, painting, sculpture, and thought it was the same thing. In fact, if I was doing a filling and the guy left, I mean, I would go leave too. Hell, I'd go outside and smoke a cigarette or whatever. I'd wait till the instructor came back because, my gosh, I was waiting till he came back because I knew I wasn't even going to think about having another dentist come in here and look at some qualitative thing. The bipolar continuum of life and death says everything is growing or dying. You need to be growing continually, says Tony Robbins. Abraham Maslow is one of the most genius psychologists ever to live. He wrote a book, Theory of Human Motivation, and read Maslow's Theory on Management. That was just genius. But everybody starts out, these were his hierarchical needs in 1940, came out with. Bottom is physiological needs. Everybody, first and foremost, needs food, water, and sex. These are the fundamental drives. If you don't eat, if you don't drink water, you're dead in about 3 days. If you don't eat, you're dead in a month. And most importantly, sex. If one species forgets to have sex, you're not here 4 billion years later. You know, they think the planet Earth was inoculated by one life form, probably a virus, 4 billion years ago. Due to evolution and mutation and everything that Darwin said, 4 billion years later, you got about 100 million species that have either that are still here or come and gone here from a dinosaur to a bacteria to a virus to you. And you know what? You cannot be standing here 4 billion years later if there wasn't a continuous chain of life all the way back to the first thing 4 billion years ago, and then before that, wherever the hell that came from. So, and in humans, who was given the sex drive? The male. I mean, women say, well, we got a sex drive, but you don't even know what a sex drive is compared to males if you study all other mammals. You might have an intellectual sex drive, but men are given this burden. You see that in all the mammals. And after a man and a woman are not hungry, they're not thirsty, they're not horny, then they move up to level two, security needs. They need a clothing and shelter. And then as soon as they're not hungry, thirsty, and horny, and they got clothes and shelter, then they need a friend. Why? Because mammals are interdependent. They're conformists. Why is that? You could not survive on your own. You only survive in a group. So go back through the jungle. If you were in a jungle of 25 apes 3-4 million years ago, in fact, the oldest hominid fossil ever found, Lucy, is right here at Arizona State University. She was a 40-inch tall, 40-pound, 17-year-old chick. I'm sure that guy had a 12-pack who mated with her. And you sit there, and if she was driven out of the pack, she would have died. She'd been eaten that night, carnivores, whatever, okay? So all humans have a massive belongingness need, and that drives you to conform. For instance, if you go into the first grade, ask old class of first graders, how many people when they grow up want to be an artist? They all raise their hand. Come back in the fifth grade. How many want to be an artist? There's like two guys raise their hand. Come back 12th grade. Nobody raise their hand. Every year of school that goes by, you have more and more pressure to conform. Because if you don't conform to the group needs, you get ran out of the group, and you're eaten by hyenas and leopards and cheetahs, okay? So everybody has conformity. So who has the least creative thoughts? The people who have the most education. As you go further and further and further, have you ever gone to a damn dental convention? Everyone's wearing the same suit, the same shoes, the same sock. They look like a bunch of ducks. Quack, 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 all marching off of a cliff. You know who has all the creative? Look at the billionaires. My God. Has Bill Gates even had a bath in the last 10 days? Warren Buffett, he's got more hair on his eyebrows than I got on my head. Look at David Hornbrook. He's probably the single greatest cosmetic dentist that ever lived. Hell, he's got long hair, a ponytail, he's got an earring. He just tattooed 3 dolphins swimming around his arm. Hell, he's got so much self-esteem. He has independent thoughts in an interdependent world. You got to understand belongingness needs. You know, you see little kids come out. I saw the first glimpse of this in my 9-year-old. It was so damn funny. I didn't know whether to laugh or cry. He came home in third grade, and he was all sad. And I said, Eric, what's wrong? I thought he was going to cry. He was saying that his friend's mad at him. I'm like trying to be loving, concerning, like listen to the story. And I want to say, who cares about your friend? Tell him to jump off a gosh darn cliff. And until you have food, water, sex, clothes, shelter, and you have a friend, you will not go to hierarchical need number 4, which is your self-esteem. And until you have self-esteem and you start to like yourself because you have friends, because you have clothing, shelter, you're not hungry, horny, or thirsty, finally, you can reach the top, self-actualization, where you can actualize yourself. This is what the Marines are saying in the commercial, where, you know, be all that you can be. Well, you can't be all that you can be until you fulfill all the lower hierarchical needs. Physiological needs, your security needs, your belongingness needs. We all need predictability, yet we need variety. We all need private space, yet we need recognition. These are the dilemmas of the human nature. No matter what humans do, they do it for a reason of need. Tony Robbins said, to be significant, you have to be unique. To be unique causes you to be different than your peers. Yet you have strong belongingness needs. This causes an inner emotional needs conflict. Thus a saying that he has thick skin. Or they say you're an egomaniac or whatever. A coward dies a thousand deaths. A courageous man dies once. Don't worry about the crowd. And this is, even comes with L.D. Pinky. Remember, he said 2% are masters, 8% are adept, on and on and on. The six circular parameter questions, which determine your own internal self-esteem and self-actualization needs, are actually the six parameter circular questions that humans can come back to are, who am I? What do I really need? Where did all this come from? When is this realistically over? What do I really want? How will they score my life when it's over? These are questions circulating your unconscious, whether you know it or not, that determine your self-esteem, your self-actualization. And then the one circular parameter question, which determines your own external psychological safety and social needs, are simply, how can I survive long enough to reproduce and have offspring so that my species will survive? Most of that biology stuff is taken care of in a wealthy nation as the United States. And then also your behavior is shaped as you go. You do a behavior, you either get punished or the behavior is avoided and it goes away, or this behavior gets rewarded and it keeps reoccurring. And so you're either positive reinforcement or avoidance of a negative stimuli will cause the behavior to reoccur, or you'll get punishment or an extinction of a stimulus you were looking for that didn't come, and then a behavior will go away. So whatever response you already have linked to a stimulus is your anchor. Change your anchors for success. Change the way you program yourself. Did your first drink of beer taste good? Do you associate alcohol with the pleasure after the drink or the pain of the morning after? In success, people party. In failure, people ponder. Don't listen to Tony Robbins' motivation tapes. He's got Fortune Management now in dentistry. He has a whole consulting arm in dentistry. Call Fortune Management. Go see Tony Robbins. Go to his one-day seminars, two-day seminars, three-day seminar. The guy can get you to think all day long. Take your staff with you. And back to human behavior. Darwin said the number one goal of all species is to reproduce and have offspring. Target your marketing kids. If you get the kid, give them things. Mom and dad are a bonus if you can get the kid. Give them positive reinforcements. Upgrade it from just a balloon. Give them Barbie dolls if they had a root canal. Do exciting stuff. In human behavior, everybody still tries to tell everyone that all boys and girls are the same. You know it's not true. You know it's never been true. And there's nothing wrong with that. Gosh darn, do boys really want to be girls? Do girls have to be boys? We can be separate but equal. We have unique. I wouldn't want to be a woman. You shouldn't want to be a man. You should want to be yourself. A gun shoots death. I shouldn't read that one. Male tattooing, motorcycles, big houses, and sports cars are all different expressions of the same cultural drive for males to show that they are successful and can protect their females and their families. The cultural desire for tan skin came because popular in the 1920s when cars became able to take you south for a vacation. The suntan was the only proof of your vacation that you could take back home. Prior to 1920s, tan skin was associated with a low-class social worker who had to work outside on a farm. In Tahiti, a flower tucked behind a woman's right ear means that she is available. Above the left ear, closer to her heart, means she is taken. Which finger do you put your wedding ring on? Well, it's your left. You know why it's your left instead of your right? Because the left was close to your heart. I am saying these things because you just think, oh, somebody put on the left finger and that's all there is. There is a reason for everything. And I want to teach you to start finding what are the fundamental human reasons of behavior. Why did they start taking place? Why do you read a book from left to right, and in China they read a book from right to left? Because 11% of people are left-handed, and whoever started Western civilization writing back in Mesopotamia was a left-handed person and wrote left to right. even though 89% of the people reading it are right-handed. In China, the first person who started the Chinese and the Asian language was right-handed, and they read a book right to left. That's why in advertising, the backside of the journal costs more, costs the most, and the inside journal of the left first page costs less. Always get to the reason. I'm not telling you there's a reason for your practice. You need to know why Tahiti puts a flower in the left ear. I want you to start finding out, why do people do what they do? Why do women have to cover their hair in ancient churches, mosques, and synagogues when men don't? Can you answer these questions? The universal appealing sexual characteristics across all cultures are youth and health. What is dancing? Dancing is stationary locomotion. Dancing comes from men and women getting together, and by stationary locomotion, they were showing, look, I'm healthy, I'm physical fit, I could have your baby. Men shave their faces simply to look younger. If a man spends 10 minutes a day from age 18 to 60 shaving, this adds up to 2,556 hours or 106 days out of his life. Dancing is symbolic locomotion without going anywhere. Dancing used to be war dancing, and it is now sexual dancing. It shows your level of health for reproduction. By age 30, men are 15 times more likely to die from an accident than females. Throughout evolution, men have always been expendable. A city only needs one man to propagate the whole damn species. You don't understand that? Go to a cattle farm, okay? They don't need a bull for every gosh darn cow. So men were always expendable. That's why we take high risk. That's why we were in war. We're 15 times more likely to die than an accident. The goal, if your goal of the company is to make money, then something can only be efficient if it makes more money. The Delphi method of finding out what your people want is a survey. The Delphi method of survey is when you independently survey experts in the profession to see what their expert opinions are. The nominal group technique is when everyone gets a turn in a group setting, which is very structured and non-confrontational. And brainstorming is very unstructured, where you're all in the break room and you're all yelling out loud and someone's writing on the board. These are the methods to find out, what does your customer want? Take it down to the level of the billionaire ape. If you understand the ape or the monkey without a tail, you're going to make $1 billion. And then from an operational logistics point of view, take this understanding of human nature and stick it into the 5 P's. Processes, your plant, your planning and control, your parts and your people. If you take all this organizational behavior and you transform into a system of processes, plants, planning and control, parts and people, you're going to build a dental office based on human behavior that will always predict the market because you understand the nature of the beast. Thank you very much.
Distance. Yeah. going to be.
Okay, we have this.
You gotta open this.
Oh,
we see another painting. Now, this one is of a loom. I would be really. I'm sure everybody knows who the two people I'm going to call out. They're the hosts, and extremely, extremely pleasant and warm throughout the last 5 days. I'd like to introduce you to Sima's parents, Shanim and Joel.
This is women's lib, you see, she gets to talk fast.
I have been instructed by Sima to make it very short, especially her dad. He does go on, so she's warned us to be very, very brief.
I haven't said a word yet.
So let me say at the engagement a very long, dwindling story. So I'm going to make up for it. I'm going to take you down memory lane. When Sima was a very, very little girl.
Just say just a couple of words.
Thank you very much.
not good enough.
Well, thank you. Thank you, everyone, for coming here. We are blessed tonight with your presence. All our friends and family who have come from far and wide, all of you have come great distances to grace this occasion and to give us the pleasure that you do care for us. This is means a great deal to both of us, both our families. It means a great deal. We are happy that you are here. We hope that you have a wonderful time. Enjoy yourselves. And my 2 seconds are up, so I gotta go. Otherwise, I get called off later on. But don't count me out yet. I may come back.
I have a request. Mary and Zuli have asked if they can have the exclusive rights to the tape. So they would like Seema to make sure they sign that tape over. She's asking if she can have royalties. The only way, middle of negotiations right now. But the only way is, Seema, if you could just sing us a little bit. Just a little bit. Just a little bit of Mary had a little bit, please.
Three little monkeys jumping on the
bed. Thank you. Dinner will now be served. The head table will be served for dinner, followed by Shimon, Mary, Zil, and Zuli will start the buffet. And then JP, a wonderful caterer, will notify your table when you're ready to come. Thank you very much and enjoy your dinner. We'll see you in a few minutes.
My appetite is set. I want a friend, friend, some sweet tea, all safe. Shabba, I'm inside. Well, the girl, she really got to eat. And a girl, she should eat right. I will. Get your tea, I'm gonna feed myself right.
Call the Khan. Abu's brother and best man, Amin, and Sima's sister, Alia, to toast the bride and the groom.
It's a great pleasure for me to come here before you and offer a toast for Alum and Sima. But before I do that, there's a couple of things I'd like to say, if you don't mind. Number one, when Moyes made his toast, or whatever it is, two words, he said that Alum was really lucky to have Sima as a bride. It's true. Alum is very lucky. But Sima has asked me to let you know that she feels very lucky too, okay? Can't get any louder than that. Okay, number two, I mean, Aldo may be a joker, but there's a lot of other qualities he has. They're all hidden qualities, so even I don't know about them. However, there's one he does have, and that is the ability to teach. Now, I'm sure you're all confused, so to make sure you understand really well, I'm gonna have one of, actually, the alum's oldest friend come here. His name is Christophe, so you please come here. And speak to you. Don't be scared.
I'm sorry, but I can't speak English very well. That's why I'm gonna speak in another language. Yari Madat? Welcome to Alum Chosenai. Imuki Kashi Sikawai. May am Amil le Zou Yankel, ke Pucha Teros, ke Noka Mouke, Sarika Chitika. Ok, allez, Gigio, Maja Kaja. Alors, Bolivios. Alors, Cuba, Ganmarito.
I believe Alia would like to say a few words.
Recognize our parents, Lily and Mary Tua and Dylan and Chanel Samani, for the wonderful job they have done, and just to thank them for all their support and everything that they have done. It's all been great, and everyone really appreciates it.
Ladies and gentlemen, does this work? Will you please all raise your glasses to Alum and Sima for a life full of happiness and joy?
Alum was always the kind of guy who's always by the clock, you know, always on time, whatever happens. Whatever happens to be the wrong of you, you know? Oh, here's Alum.
I'm late. Oh, I was with Sima on the phone. Only 1 hour late. 1 hour? Oh, that is your watch.
You got a watch.
Look, I have a Rolex.
When Alum is willing to show up, don't ever ask him what time. Ever. But ask what day. You know, it's always more convenient to play with a cell phone. You know, I come up with new excuses for the delay. You know.
Beep, beep, beep. I'm sorry, I'm late. I fixed the car.
You fixed
yes,
the car?
Yes, my car.
What's happening again?
I call you back later.
Besides all of these pathological problems for time traveling, you know, Alum is always the first volunteer for all kinds of sports. All kinds of sports.
All kinds of sports.
And he often plays squash. He often, very often plays squash. You know, he's number one to innovate on psychological techniques in order to win.
Look, a big elephant.
Whatever happens, he hypnotizes his partner. But if it doesn't work, anyway, he always has the option to knock you down. And it works. It works. Anyway, enough of this crap, because if you're trying to give you a list of all, some kind of exhaustive list of the looms, flows, drawbacks, whatever, it might be too long. So we give up. Enough of crap. Just want to tell you, just want to take full occasion.
Enough of crap.
Now, enough of this crap. We just want to thank you, Alum. You know, we just want to tell you that whatever happens, we love you for who you are, with all your flaws, all of these weird things you're doing all the time. And we just want to tell you that you are a real.
It's too early to come and talk to you guys. You are not intoxicated enough. But I think we'd like you, you know, these guys are tongue-tied, so I'll talk for them for a second. I'd like to thank all my very dear friends and my family, Julie's family, for making this evening a very memorable evening. And I let the men talk now, because they think I don't let them talk.
I say thank you very much to all of you, for all of you, for attending this evening, this occasion, and making this the best day for us and for Alum and Sima.
Thank you.
And I hope we are going to continue dancing. I suppose it's going to go on until 1 o'clock.
2 o'clock.
So they say 2 o'clock in England, so it will be 1 o'clock here, something like that. Thank you very much indeed. We are happy, and I hope that you are happy as well.
I expected Julie and Mary to cry and get really emotional, but that's typical French. They don't show emotions.
You're the one who's emotional.
No, there's nothing. Il vaut mieux quand même que je dise quelques mots en français pour nos amis français qui sont là et nous sommes vraiment touchés. Je veux que vous sachiez que nous sommes touchés par votre présence. Merci, merci, merci beaucoup, les amis, merci.
And you know what? I came up here because I already said my word, right? I came here, I thought I was going to get some gifts.
Here's your gift.
Yeah, thanks.
Before you leave, I just want to one more time, could you please give these four people a wonderful applause, because they have done an extremely good job. Ladies and gentlemen,
Alum and Sima. It's always
Sima and Alum.
Alum and Sima.
I broke the Sabatia love, but it was a trick Sabatia, and I'm really the boss.
Before Sima starts, I just want to say, Sima, tonight, you have made a new definition of the word bride, am I correct?
Yeah.
You look absolutely beautiful.
I don't think I can beat what everyone has said tonight. Farah and Mo have done an incredible job, and everyone else who's done their speeches have been just amazing. It's kept everybody laughing, and that's what we wanted. Alumina wanted to thank everybody for being here today and making it such a special day for us. And all of those people come from all over the place, including France. And we